to the last panel, the panel analysis of Latin corrective actions. We are going to change a little bit the order of the speakers. We are going to start with the cause of cracks, why the cracks appears. This talk will be given by Urs. Then I will show some practical examples of cracks at sites. And finally, Kim will talk a little bit about the technologies to avoid these cracks in soft cases. So we can start now with Urs Müller. Urs Müller, PhD, educated in geoscience as a mineralogist at the University of Karlsruhe, Germany, specialized on building materials under his PhD thesis, has been working for the last 15 years with materials properties of cement and concrete, and has been active in US, Germany, and now in Sweden, in RISE.
I'm not an engineer. I will discuss this a little bit more from the material perspective with some engineering input. So, cracking in concrete is actually, now I don't know why this is increased, but anyway, cracking in concrete is actually nothing unusual. As you all know, concrete is a composite of binder material with aggregate, and by reducing water, it is prone to cracking. So the cause actually of the cracking is within the binder paste. But it's not a question of avoiding cracks completely. This is probably not possible, but to control and to minimize it. And of course, what Sarah said, there are different qualities of cracks. We have cracks on an engineering level, which can impair engineering performance. And then you have the Euro codes and national codes who are giving how do you do it. I will show this later. But there's also maybe other qualities of cracking, for instance, for aesthetical appearance. A lot of constructors working in the building industry, they want to just avoid cracks because it doesn't look nice and the client is complaining then. So. Cracks are caused by a multitude of reasons. And one important reason is, as Sarah also pointed out, is a material. This is actually the composite character of concrete. The binder material is prone to cracking. And we have very early cracking in the plastic stage, which is called plastic, or which can be caused by a plastic shrinkage. So volume changes of the material can be a cause of cracking if those volume changes are restrained. And when volume changes are restrained, then cracking will appear. Of course, also important is volume changes due to hydration, shrinkage due to hydration. And here we summarize this as autogenous shrinkage, which includes also chemical shrinkage and self-desiccation shrinkage. Chemical shrinkage is just based on the fact that the volume of the starting materials, the binder, dry binder plus water mixed, has a higher volume, I think around 15%, than the hydrates, reaction products. So, but then we have also, of course, drying shrinkage. And drying shrinkage, self-desiccation shrinkage, and plastic shrinkage, they are actually based on enforcement of capillary forces or capillary stress within the pore system of the material. So further volume changes can be, of course, based on temperature. Everybody knows that during hydration, this is an exothermic reaction, so hydration of cement, and it will increase the temperature of the concrete. And due to the temperature differences, the temperature gradients, forces can, or stress can cause, and of course, cracking can then be caused by tensile stresses on the outside of the concrete. But then we have also other volume changes, for instance, carbonation shrinkage, when not only calcium hydroxide carbonates, but the entire binder paste, also for instance CSH phases or other hydration products, for instance AFM or ettringite. Then we know other causes of cracking, which are partially based, physically based, but also partially based on expansive reaction within the concrete microstructure. Everybody knows frost degradation, which causes surface cracking, surface spalling, but also internal cracking. Then we have reinforcement corrosion, which is, I think, around 80% to 90% responsible for degradation processes in concrete. And this can be, of course, due to carbonation or depassivation by chloride of the reinforcement. And here you can see a column which is cracked due to carbonation of the concrete and then the formation of voluminous reaction products at the reinforcement level. Other degradation reactions are alkali-silica reactions. This is quite a hideous form of reaction because it affects the entire concrete bulk. It's not only coming from the outside, it's essentially happening in the entire concrete bulk, and this is quite expensive to repair. And then we have also something like sulfate attack, which is coming from outside ingressing sulfides into the concrete. And can also cause expensive reaction, which in the end result in cracking. And then, of course, we have external stresses. And usually, from an engineering point of view, please correct me if I'm wrong, those include usually stresses with a tensile stress component. So we have flexural stresses, shear stresses, or pure tensile stresses, or something like a splitting tensile stress. When we look at those causes for, we can, as I say, we can have material related volume changes, and when those volume changes happen and they are restrained, then cracking will happen. Then we have degradation processes which can cause cracking, and we have more from the engineering point of view, external stresses, loading scenarios, which can cause stresses, which are often, it can be static, dynamic, or can be caused by creep. When we look at what the codes provide, actually, this is what we had just initially discussed. There's some guidance here. We have for crack width limitations in concrete structures, we can refer to the Eurocode 2, where you find this table 7.1n, which is giving guidance about maximum allowed crack width for different exposure scenarios. And also these reinforcement conditions. And also national guidelines or national standards, they have often special requirements or limitations for maximum crack width when it concerns specific structural parts, for instance, for watertight concrete or for containers which contain dangerous liquid goods, for instance. So then often there are special requirements for the crack width. So how do we control cracks? Here again, from the engineering point of view, there are precautions. This is usually done by the amount of reinforcement and how the reinforcement is brought into this. Again here, this is some guidance can give the Eurocode or the Eurocodes and also national guidelines. Here in the Eurocode is actually also prescribed how much reinforcement material needs to be calculated for limit those crack width. Also in the Eurocodes are there are information about pre-stress reinforcement in order to reduce crack width. For crack risk minimizations from the application side, I think this is also important in which can help when a concrete is placed, what can be done in order to minimize the crack risks. And for the thermal gradient, there is an old method for cooling actually the concrete. This can be done by by externally or internally, for instance, by cooling coils. There's a nice movie when they built the Hoover Dam, and they put on kilometers of copper coils into the concrete in order to cool it down during the hydration. And I think the same they have done for the dam in China. So they built in a lot of copper coils or metal coils. I think in China, in this Three Gorge Dam, they put in stainless steel coils for cooling down the concrete, because the amount of concrete is so high that you need to do something. Another measure is, for instance, heating the formwork in winter. This is in particular from the country I'm working now in Scandinavia, or in northern countries where you have quite high gradients during the winter time from maybe hydrating concrete in the inner part of 30, 50 degrees to the outer part of maybe 5 degrees, so or under 5 degrees, which can cause stresses then. So, and this strategy in Nordic countries is then often to heat the concrete during the initial setting and the beginning of the onset of the hydration. Then, of course, structural design optimization is also an issue to provide joints, construction joints, and so to avoid unnecessary restraints, and also to have a geometric optimization for the design of the structure to avoid, again, restraints. For the drying, this is in order to, during the application of the concrete and during the curing of the concrete, is essentially a possibility to, as Sarah mentioned, to cover the concrete by a membrane, by a sheet. There are also curing agents on the market, which can be sprayed on the concrete and which reduce essentially the water vapor pressure of the water on the interface water atmosphere, and by this prevent a too quick evaporation of the. You can see this here in this graph down here. This green dotted line is essentially, and which goes when a curing agent would be used, and this. Red line is when you water the concrete surface frequently in the beginning. When you don't do anything, it will this capillary pressure will go up, and so with the up with the increase of the capillary pressure, the risk for cracking is also there. Another more from the compositional side of the concrete. You were mentioning slag. You can use either lower the cement clinker content. You can add a type 1 filler, an inert filler, or you can put in a SCM, or can use a composite cement. And you can see you can quite drastically reduce the heat of hydration by adding, reducing the clinker content of the cement, of the binder. And by this, avoid temperature-related cracking, which is also be done for massive structures. They usually have a low cement content, low clinker content, and often they use also secondary, supplementary cementitious materials or rock fillers or both for limiting the maximum heat of hydration. Of course, also the general mix design can be optimized by also using a good sieve curve for the aggregate, and adjust this to the amount of binder, and limit also the binder, water binder ratio. Nowadays it's not such a big problem any longer, because we can use water reducing agents essentially for this. There exist also concrete admixtures which limit shrinkage and thus also reduce possibility of cracking, and those are called shrinkage reducing admixtures. They are usually based on alcohol derivatives, and they are mixed into the concrete during the preparation. Maybe I can show this picture again. They work in a very early age, though they are good for plastic shrinkage and autogenous shrinkage, but they are also working over longer time periods on this drying shrinkage. There also exist shrinking compensating agents. They are a little bit less known, and those are usually based on expensive minerals, which are finally dispersed, mixed into the concrete, and which act at in parallel during the shrinkage process, and by this, in theory at least, compensates the shrinkage. And nowadays, over the last, I think, 10 years, also another type of material has been emerged, kind of a smart admixture. Those are super absorbing polymers, which are mixed also into the concrete, and which give counteract self-desiccation by providing water. This is also to a certain degree valid for drying shrinkage. But at the moment, I think it's still hard to dose those super absorbent polymers into the concrete in a way that has really an effect. It's still a little bit tricky to do this on an industrial scale. So I want to just conclude with this. What are the actually practical needs? We were talking about monitoring this morning, and for crack monitoring, there are different systems now under watch. This can be done by robots or by drones or by internal sensors. But of course, as we already saw this morning, how do we process those data? How do we ensure that those data can be read in 100 years? And one thing we didn't discuss is also data security. You don't want to have somebody screwing up your monitoring data just by out of pleasure because some hacker takes some pride in penetrating a monitoring system which is maybe handling monitoring data from thousands of structures. So this is also, I think, an issue we haven't thought about yet, but it probably will come up. When we look at smart admixtures for crack healing or crack mitigation, at the moment I think we are more on this volume change part, that those smart admixtures, when a crack appears to a certain degree due to restrained volume change, that it can fill in. For degradation, when we have cracks due to degradation, is actually already over. So when you have ASR, for instance, and you have a cracking, then it doesn't help when you fill in this, it will still be damaged. And the same is for reinforcement corrosion, it will still be a problem. And for more external stresses, I think it's also difficult to, at the moment, to regain structural health by crack healing. I think those, when we talk about crack healing, it's more to plug the cracks to prevent ingressing damaging materials into the concrete, but it will not recover structural performance at the moment. And maybe this is a challenge, that we formulate admixtures which can do this to regain structural performance. But also are cheap enough or inexpensive enough to actually be implemented into a bulk concrete. And this is, I think, the price factor is, I didn't list this here, but the price factor is quite important because when we work with bulk concrete, it can be quite a lot. And if the price is too high, we cannot use it because then the price of the concrete is going up too much. So other strategy would be to, how can we change the concrete production process, and how can we change the process of casting concrete to maybe accommodate those smart admixtures at places where they are most needed. So this is also another challenge. Okay, this was it, and thank you for your attention.
Thanks.